May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our Savior and Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Well, good morning, St. Phillips.
Good morning.
Is anybody else sprouting a little mold or a moss here and there? I know it's nice to be able to have at least a little bit of time to walk the dogs, breathe downpours. I don't know how long of a break we have, but it's nice, isn't it?
Yes.
Today's gospel reading is actually two passages from Mark, as bookends to a lot of high activity in between that we'll get to next week. I love Mark. In some ways, he is my favorite of all gospel writers. He cuts right to the chase. There's no incarnation stories. There's no post-resurrection stories. We get 3 years in and out, we're done. Here, the disciples are returning from their first time of being sent out by Jesus to heal and teach. They went out with an open posture, no hidden agendas, no power plays. They went out with a message of love and repentance that pointed to God and a power to heal and reconcile. They believed in that power. They are probably full of stories, some good and some bad. The disciples probably heard about John the Baptist. They're probably exhausted. And all they want at the end of this first road trip is some time with Jesus to decompress, to share their experiences, get a pat on the back, maybe, and regroup with their friends. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, as it were, Jesus has been swamped. People have found him. The secret is out. Crowds are surrounding him for healing and teaching and preaching. Jesus' ministry of healing on physical, spiritual, and relational levels is constant. He can't catch a break. So Jesus says to his disciples, "Come away with me to a deserted place all by ourselves and rest a while." Now, wouldn't life be nice if that's how the story usually goes? I mean, I'd like that. Would you? Okay, world, you stop, and when it gets overwhelming, I'll go to my quiet place, like I'll crawl into my hole and pull the rock in over me. And then, when I'm ready, the pace can resume, and I'll crawl back out. Wouldn't we like that? As much as I may long for that deserted space, though, that's not how my life usually works. And that's not how it worked in this story for the disciples. There was no deserted place. The crowds kept following. And the real message of the gospel is that Jesus has compassion for them. Jesus taught them. And wherever he went, he kept healing them. I remember not too far into being ordained as a deacon in an active multi-generational church and working full-time outside of the church in a human needs area with a family and having middle school daughters at the time. And if you ever had middle school daughters, knowing the moments that go with that, and saying to my supervising priest, "I don't think I can do this. I zigged when I should have zagged. The world keeps coming at me. I go through each day in this open posture of being a Christian, and stuff keeps coming. I get stuck all over me." flow of neediness and the emotions surrounding medical issues and the fear and anger and separation that seems to be part of the warp and woof and weave of our current culture that I encounter. And my supervising priest back then told me a story of feeling the same way when he was younger. And going to his mentor, who looked wisely at him and sighed knowingly, and handed him a piece of paper and said, "Well, yes, we've all been there. And here's the hospital and room number for Joe Smith, who's having open heart surgery tomorrow. And he's really scared. He needs to see you. Let me know how a visit goes." And the priest said that after he got dragging himself to the hospital and into the room for the visit, he realized that he left feeling a whole lot better than when he got there, because he was exactly where he was supposed to be in life, as messy and chaotic as it can be, and not in a deserted place. This is the theology and the ethical response of today's gospel reading. God has been revealed over history in personal and intimate relation to the world over time through acts of compassion. Translated in the German, Mitleid, with suffering. This is the same God who is incarnate in Jesus, who has compassion on the crowds, and who will exhibit the ultimate passion of Christ, the ultimate healing and reconciliation of the world. This is not God going to a deserted place. This is not God crawling in a hole and pulling a rock in over God's head. Response to this divine nature of God, or how we live in response to this divine nature of God, is to live into this world in all its neediness as disciples of Christ, bearing the healing power of God's love. Unconditionally, no agenda. Wherever we are, in our homes, our neighborhoods, even the Walmart checkout line, social media pages, our church, civic groups, with people we know and people we don't know, with people we like, and people we probably would rather not spend much time with.
Disciplines that keep me on track are these. The first is kind of obscure.
easier said than done. I get flashes of God, and then it's gone. The second discipline is the passing of the peace in our liturgy. Jesus healed not only spiritually and physically, but also relationally. When we look out on this world, relational healing is needed now more than ever. It's far too easy for people to retreat into places of brokenness, separation, and camps. The place we get to build that muscle of relationship is right here every Sunday. Contrary to popular belief, the passing of the peace is not a liturgical aerobic moment to stretch legs and say hello to friends. It is a place specifically in the service after the lectionary and preaching and prayers and confession so that we can have time to right any relationships that might be off kilter before we come to the communion rail to share in the body of Christ. We are given an opportunity to heal schisms between ourselves so that our reunion in Christ will fully make us one with God. It used to be that the people would be counseled to leave the church at that moment and right any wrongs before they came back for communion. But that practice was discontinued when church leaders became afraid the church would empty out and nobody would come back. And we'd be the first ones to have to leave and never come back. As followers of Christ, we are all called by our baptismal covenant to open spaces and channel God's healing power in this world. It's not a clergy prerogative. It's total ministry, the ministry of all of us as Christians. We're not often going to be given deserted places to retreat to. And if we are, it won't be for a long stretch of time.